Welcome to this episode of Eureka, and we are going to have a very informative conversation with Professor Devi Prasad Sarkar. He is a professor of biochemistry at Delhi University. Do you know that people say that you can cut a diamond with diamond? Can you cure diseases infecting some person with virus? That's a kind of very interesting activity that people are engaged in. We are going to discuss about this in the show. Keep watching Eureka, but before that, let's take a look at his brief profile.
Virologists play a very important role in public health, and it is where Professor Devi Sarkar has extensively worked. Currently, Dr. Sarkar is the professor of biochemistry department at Delhi University. Professor Sarkar's researches on Sendai virus is known to have resulted in the development of reconstituted viral envelopes containing only the fusion protein, and this is reported to have assisted in a more efficient gene delivery in therapeutic use. He was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology, one of the highest Indian science awards in 1998, for his contributions to biological sciences. Dr. Sarkar did his graduation in chemistry and obtained a master's degree in biochemistry in 1980, both from Banaras Hindu University. Later on, he pursued his PhD degree from University of Calcutta in 1986. His postdoctoral studies were at the National Cancer Institute of the National Institutes of Health. And after that, Dr. Sarkar joined the Delhi University as a lecturer of biochemistry. Along with Vijay Kumar, he demonstrated for the first time that HBx protein stimulated mitogen-activated signaling cascades in living animals. He holds patents for his inventions. Some of the inventions have resulted in patent cooperation treaties, earning royalties for the university.
Thank you for being with us in the show. It's a very wonderful opportunity. And let's start with the beginning of your career in research. You did your PhD in Calcutta.
Yes.
That time the institute was also named completely differently, right? Indian Institute of Experimental Medicine.
Right.
Yeah, so where people were looking at how you can use knowledge of science to cure diseases. So what was your essential work in a PhD? What exactly is the question that you tackled?
So there are a lot of bacteria pathogen, like pneumococcus, these, that many. So they have a lot of cell wall that is called polysaccharide. There's one of the major antigen. So rather than taking those, because you have to use the time and like all these things, you have to apply your mind and have to get trained of all the modern technology. So far, that time available. I joined now formally 81 sometime.
Okay.
So I started with a model antigen, like all this model drug, model antigen. It's a small stretch of oligosaccharide, sugar. So I used to attach it to the liposome as a carrier and used to inject rabbit to elicit antibodies against the sugar.
Okay.
So that really is the field of, I will not say immunology, immunochemistry, which is my field of choice. I like chemistry because I am by training a chemist, later on specialization biochemistry, but although degree was MSc biochemistry, but whole chemistry. So chemistry is in my blood even today, and I believe without chemistry, physics, maths, biology is impossible. That is my personal perception.
Yeah.
So I pursue.
So in your PhD, you are trying to look at using a model membrane. How a membrane will produce antigens.
Membrane will help to produce antibodies against a particular antigen, which I used to hook it to the liposome membrane.
So, you did your studies in India. I mean, you worked in one of, that time, the topmost scientific institution, IIEM. And then you got an opportunity to go to National Cancer Institute in US.
Right.
In those days, quite obviously, that place would have been a very, very different place in terms of opportunity, work culture. What change, what shift you saw?
It was a technology bloom that time. Like for instance, one example, tissue culture technique. We never saw a tissue culture in that IICB. That time name was changed to II, Indian Institute of Chemical Biology. Immediately I was exposed to all this technology, live cell is growing in the culture. That itself is amazing for me. I heard it in my papers, discussion, journal club, but never had the chance to do the tissue culture to begin with one. And there's, of course, there's no email that time. nothing in the internet. But the way technology was, I said, my God, another Makkah. I've come to another Makkah and another guru. He's also Blumenthal. So fourth B in my life.
Mm. That's a very interesting point. So you saw a very different kind of culture in terms of equipment. What about the culture of learning, culture of teaching, culture of doing science? How different it was it?
Our culture is tremendously much, much better than that time in India. Of course, under Guruji, you are trained like that. But there I found much more. Everybody is talking there. Monday to Friday, they work 5 days a week. Saturday, Sunday, only Indian and Japanese and Chinese. Believe it. So even Blumenthal seldom used to come. But Monday to Friday, nothing else other than the profession and science. Everything, loyal lunch. I used to go with Blumenthal, all my colleagues, only science, sometimes jokes, but maximum is only science, how to improve, how to do it, everyday journal club, everyday like data club, like come Devi, sit with all your data, everybody will criticize. Now, there important one thing I heard, I learned, although I got a prime, negative control of experiment. How much negative way you can design your control, positive is fine, many more negative control, Devi, your data is not good. How to prove it? What more control you can do? They used to chew the data.
Yes,
like
that's, I think, a very important point, right? Because science is organized skepticism.
Absolutely.
So the negative control gives you that kind of a step, I mean, a confidence.
Yes.
Now, let me shift to a very, very basic question. I mean, most of us would have studied chemistry in our schools, right?
Right.
In school, of course, we also study that chemistry is divided largely into two groups, organic and inorganic. And we also understand that inorganic is about metals, you know, I mean, salts, etc. And organic is about carbon-based, essentially something related to life. Where does the biochemistry come in? How is biochemistry different from organic chemistry?
Okay. To begin with, very quickly, that earlier there was no biochemistry. When Guruji started his career, he was applied chemist, organic chemist. Like, for instance, our Honorable Khurana sir, Hargobind Khurana ji, he was a chemist, synthetic organic chemist. What he did? He synthesized the first gene in the world, U.
Okay.
By applying chemistry. Now, answering your now question, if you got a bit hints that chemistry, particularly organic chemistry and biochemistry, there is no difference to me, even today. Because in between, I felt some difference that we are dealing with living system. Then I felt, oh my God, what I'm thinking? All the enzymes I'm isolating, the cell is dead, we are extracting out. There is no relevance. So there now this technology today, like you can even image a whole cell with the help of CCD, with the help of laser. Now everything like enzyme action, you can monitor online. All the cell-cell fusion like sperm and egg fusing, making an embryo, you can just online monitor it. Like, so now I feel that although the difference is life, okay. Biochemistry. And organic chemistry is well, not non-life, with the help of catalyst, with the help of everything, A plus B, C. Same thing, A plus B, C is happening in our body, but then the thermodynamics of the reaction is a bit different. But to me, if you ask today, I don't find any difference between organic chemistry and biochemistry.
That's a very interesting point, and this is where we'll take a very, very short break. Keep watching, Eureka. After the break, we are going to ask him, what was that mystery when Professor Maan Singh wanted to meet him alone under a tree in this university? Keep watching Eureka. After the break, we are going to discuss with him how he got his Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very interesting, very powerful conversation with Dr. Devi Prasad Sarkar. He is the professor of biochemistry at Delhi University. And we want to now shift to your seminal work, which got you the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. So let's start with some fundamental question. Virus, that's one of the area that you have been working. I mean, when it affects, most of us think it causes disease. Does all virus that comes into our body cause disease?
No.
So, how do you differentiate them?
Okay, there are viruses, they are cell-specific, organ specific, even animal specific. Okay. Some may cause disease in rats, some may not. Some may cause in human, but if in general, if anything causing human in general, but no, not really true. It is a specific case. Host virus is very specific interaction.
So which means that a virus which may cause disease in rat perhaps may not cause anything in human at all.
No.
So it doesn't mean that every virus is actually a disease causing organism.
No, not every virus.
Okay.
Infection and disease, there is a great difference.
Okay. So it may be infected and then it may be just silent.
You may be making his progeny, keeping the host intact, making happy. If you keep on taking energy, food, he will be happy. Virus will be happy. I will be happy. A host will be happy.
So this is how you hit upon a virus which led you to your seminal work, right? So can you tell us about that specific work,
Sendai virus. This is a virus which was discovered in early 50s in a place in Japan called Sendai.
Okay.
That's why the name is a popular name. Scientific name is hemagglutinin. It's not even scientific, hemagglutinin virus of Japan.
Uh-huh.
But its real scientific name is a paramyxovirus. Paramyxovirus, okay. Under the family of mumps, measles, rinderpest, a lot of cattle viruses.
Okay.
So the basic structure is same, but fortunately, there are enough background. When I was in National Cancer Institute under Dr. Blumenthal, I initially did some work on Sendai virus. Then I switched over to influenza, but then I found they're the same kind of viruses. So then when I joined in 88 November, under the leadership of Professor Bimal Bachawat, and then I got a challenge that now, Devi, now you, the gun is on your shoulder. You fire it yourself. Now you cannot put the gun. So they be prepared for your independent research life and teaching. So teaching and research, I feel they are equally. So there I picked up the Sendai virus because it is not pathogenic to human being.
Okay.
Although there are a lot of restrictions that are not there in terms of ethical these days, just because it is non-pathogenic. So I took up and used to grow in chick embryo. 10 days old fertilized chick embryo. And that is about, I started my life 10 eggs in the beginning in South Campus. And it was just limited fund, I'll not say limited, good, I say fund from Department of Science and Technology. That was my first funding, about 10 lakhs in 1998 or 91. Then I started working with the virus because the virus mechanism of entry inside the host cell, host is a very broad, starting from animal, duck, chicken, to human, they equally almost infect. And then rats and rodents, they cause disease, but not in human. So golden opportunity, then a mechanism of infection or entry is much known. So I thought how to take the molecule of my interest, like drugs, to begin with, model drug, then real drug, then even gene. Because the gene therapy boom started coming in 1989.
Okay.
French Anderson, Inder Burma, in the US and even Japan. They are trying to cure a metabolic disorder, genetic disorder, with the help of replacing the gene.
Okay.
So then I found that this virus can be utilized if you engineer appropriately, then you can take this virus to the cell of our choice, like liver in our body.
Okay. So what you are saying is that you wanted to use this virus as a mechanism, as a delivery mechanism.
Delivery vector.
To deliver drug or a gene.
Gene.
To different parts. So that is what is the examination.
Only to liver.
To the liver. Why liver?
Oh, because the way I engineered the virus with the groundwork which was established by Japan, US scientists, European scientists, Netherlands scientists, they gave a big clue that this virus can be taken to only hepatocyte liver cell of our body. So they did everything in the culture, in the human liver cell in the culture, but nobody attempted a virus, a Sendai modified virus, to take it to the liver cell because liver cell has a receptor which can recognize a particular moiety of the Sendai virus component. And that is a great affinity. In physical chemistry, we say our highest affinity possible. Like, although really not the highest affinity, but a high affinity, I'll say. So that affinity constant, physical chemistry binding constant, is good enough that it can be taken to the, because in our body, see, there are thousands of molecules are interacting, Brownian motions all the time. It's very difficult to control. But if the affinity is very high, then I thought that we can take it in the intact animal.
Okay, but why liver? Why people are interested in liver?
The liver is known to be the metabolic headquarters of our body.
Okay.
Most of the important proteins of blood, albumin, other than immunoglobulins, and there are a lot of enzymes like bilirubin degrading enzyme, that factor 8, factor 9, all the blood clotting factors, and many complement proteins in the blood are made from the hepatocytes, and they're the highest secretory cells of the body so far known.
Okay.
That's
okay.
Why I thought if I can take a piece of, see, I started with model drug. Then, like, I started my life with iodinated small protein lysozyme. Mm-hmm. At that time, fluorescent proteins, GFP, RFP, not available. Iodinated protein is a big risk. 125 isotope, gamma emitting. So we took proper control, and you probe it, so just to probe whether it is going to liver or not. Mm-hmm. So use this virus, put the iodinated protein inside the, replacing the RNA, mm-hmm. and then you started in culture, then went to the animal, mm-hmm. in the mouse model. We found out of our, not surprise, expectation with the chemistry, whatever I understood, even today, that yes, it may hit only the liver cell. But of course, nothing is ideal in the world, not 100%. But believe me, with all said and done, with all stringent controls and experiments, including mouse model, with the help of a lot of collaborators in Delhi, in India, as well as outside, abroad, we really were successful to put it
into the cells. Let me understand. So what you did was that you took this virus, you put a kind of a radioactive element inside it.
Right.
And then injected it into a, let's say, a
mouse.
So, and then you found that which part of the body it is going.
Right.
And then you found that largely it is going
80% is going.
So it means that we can be very sure that this is targeting that particular
That liver, yeah.
Yeah. This is where, for example, one of your major paper was read by a person who became your close friend and a collaborator subsequently.
Yes.
And then brought a new dimension to this whole research, right?
Absolutely.
So who is that person? What happened?
Yeah. Cut a long story short, it is Professor Jayant Rai Choudhury. He's a gastroenterologist from Calcutta Medical College. He is almost right more than 45 years in Albert Einstein College of Medicine.
Mm-hmm.
It was precisely 94 when some of the basic work was published in some of the that time leading journal, even today. Dr. Sandeep Basu, the then director of National Institute of Immunology, called me on the landline. There's no mobile. Devi, your work has been cited in a journal called Hepatology Elsewhere. He's a man of, he was also trying gene therapy for the bilirubin problem, type 1 jaundice.
Uh-huh.
It's a rat model. He made a very good forecast of your work. Did you see him? No. Okay, send me somebody. I'll xerox it and give it to you. At time, no, other than library. So immediately I sent somebody. NII is very close to South Campus.
Yeah.
My God. They say they profoundly praise the work. They say it can be a future promising vehicle for gene therapy delivery. Subsequently, I'm not a therapy man, in delivery. So immediately I contacted through great difficulty that time, but nothing is impossible, I believe. Things are tough. I didn't leave it. I happened to be in 97 in NCI,
mm-hmm.
National Cancer Institute, under Dr. Blumenthal's invitation. I was somehow with my postdoc contacts, my Calcutta friends, my Indian friends, somebody I found, Dr. Devasis Mitra, who is right now in CDFD director, Hyderabad.
Mm-hmm.
He's not him, his wife, Sutopa Mitra.
Mm-hmm.
She was working in the same building, almost same floor, Albert Einstein College of Medicine, Bronx, New York. Oh, Devida, we'll take you to Professor Rai Choudhury. No appointment, nothing. I went. I found he's surrounded by many people from India. One of them was Dr. Sib Sarin. Professor Sib Sarin, the founder of the Liver Research Center in Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
My God, I first saw and then, I had to wait. Then I could meet him. He said, yes, Devi Sarkar, Dr. Sarkar, initially Dr. Sarkar, now it is Devi. I'm my elder brother. He said, okay, why don't you take the gene responsible for degrading bilirubin in the blood? And that's what the disorder is, type 1 jaundice, Crigler-Najjar syndrome. Type 1 jaundice,
mm-hmm.
bilirubin, UDP, glucuronosyl transferase. You have the gene, human copy, take it, go to Delhi, wrap it in your engineered virus, send me back. I came back, I was excited. We amplified the gene, we made in milligram quantity or microgram quantity with my students, all my colleagues, wrapped it, then how to send it?
That is where I think we are going to take a break. We need to have a small substance in any story, right?
Yes.
So we'll take a very short break. Keep watching, Vireka. How did they send this modified virus and what happened after? This is a small substance. Keep watching, Vireka. After the break, we'll continue this conversation.
मिले सस्ता इलाज, इसीलिए सरकार लगाती है दवा के दामों पर नियंत्रण। लेकिन दवा कंपनियों का भी है अपना तर्क, उन्हें करना होता है नई दवाओं का विकास। ऐसे में क्या होनी चाहिए दवाओं के दामों को लेकर सरकार की नीति, कुछ ऐसे विषयों पर करेंगे विचार। देखिए मेरे साथ अर्थनीति शनिवार शाम 7:30 बजे सिर्फ राज्यसभा टेलीविजन पर।
Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful conversation with Professor Devi Prasad Sarkar. He is a professor of biochemistry at Delhi University South Campus. Before the break, we left it at suspense. You got the genes, you re-engineered the virus, and then you had to send the sample to US. How did you do? FedEx?
No. Nothing was available. No FedEx, no courier, internet, nothing. So Guruji, Professor Bachaut, taught us a technique. That time, if it is a really dying emergency, how to do it? He has all innovative ideas. He said, once he sent a few years back to somebody in US, he sent somebody to the airport, Delhi airport, with a paper, some paper material, and said, somebody, go, keep on asking who is going to JFK, New York, George F. Kennedy, okay? So he was successful. And he also received, by the way, the recipient also sent this way from NIH, from NCI, somebody, my colleague, Professor Bijay Chaudhary, I can name it with real proud. Okay, now I remembered, my God, let me try. So along with my students, we went to the Delhi airport, trying to mimic the same history repeats. Believe it, one by one. Then I found somebody, one lady, whom I knew, who did PhD, first PhD student of Professor Amitabh Chattopadhyay in CCMB, Hyderabad. So, sir, you are here? I mean, Susmita, where are you going? Sir, New York, I got a postdoc position, just finished PhD. I mean, Susmita, this is the packet with the ice, wet ice, no dry ice that time, not available. This is important material which has to be delivered to Professor Rai Chaudhary. Somebody will come to JFK once you agree. She immediately agreed. Yes, sir, I will take it. Susmita is still US, so she carried it. Somebody came to JFK from Dr. Rai Chaudhary's lab. They picked it and the 6 rats. They are having jaundice called GUN rats, G-U-N-N, by some scientists made it in Philadelphia long back. They are having genetically defective, not to able to produce the enzyme from liver. So he injected and he found a miraculous, not a very high one, but a very miraculous lowering of the bilirubin level in the GUN rat, in the blood. So that is the seminal point.
So that is how this virus can be used as a vehicle, got proved, right, at least for this particular disease, and then opened up a new idea. One of the difference between this virus and retrovirus is very, very important in terms of drug delivery, right? So what is the significance of this virus in comparison to retrovirus?
See, all retroviruses in general, they're RNA virus. In fact, they are. But RNA, why they're retro, is they can make, with the help of a reverse transcriptase, they can make a DNA of their own. Okay. This virus, although a negative stranded RNA virus, Sendai, even influenza, they don't have the opportunity to make their DNA copy. So they are non-retrovirus. The advantage and disadvantage both. Advantage is tremendous. They cannot go into the nucleus. Their RNA cannot go into the nucleus. Although I eliminated all the RNA, but even a trace molecule, one or two molecules in Avogadro scale is there, they have the chance to go to nucleus and they may integrate. He had it been a retrovirus. So we are not touching the genome of our host cell.
Okay, so when you are using this Sendai kind of virus, it doesn't make any change, or rather the chances of any change inadvertently happening to our DNA is near.
So far tested, nothing.
That's a very, very interesting research work of yours, where you are trying to use a Sendai virus to as a vehicle for drug delivery and perhaps even gene therapy. But then why Professor Maan Singh wanted to meet you under a tree after you did this research?
So that was exactly when the Vatnagar Award was declared in 1998, sometime in September. So he called me. He used to call me, Devi Beta, you come, I will meet you. I said, where? You come under some area in the lawn. I went, I met him. He hugged me, said, Devi Beta, I'm very happy. You got this award. We are proud of you. we are all proud of you. Everybody, you are doing very good. But I called you for some specific purpose. Mm-hmm. Well, sir, I got little worried because I was kind of pressuring him for a long time for my love space, my house, this, that, like the way director is being requested by his colleagues. So Devi, I'm very happy, Devi beta. But see, I'll tell you one thing. You got Bhatnagar. Definitely very good for you and for the university and for the nation. But you keep it on. Keep up the spirit. But one thing I'll tell you, that's why I called you, that Devi, irrespective of you get anything, so long you are in a system of our university right now, I cannot do a miracle. In overnight, I cannot promote you to anything which you are, of course, everybody aspire or deserve. So better keep it controlled and keep doing good work, irrespective of whether you are getting promotion, not these, that, work hard. That was the thing which I really, then I, tears came in my ears. Sir, Guruji, I said, sir, professor, sir, you told the right thing which Professor Bachaud, that time he was not there, my Guruji. So, sir, everybody is telling that, my parents, my teachers, you are also in like that, you are my teacher. I totally obeyed and I totally accepted.
Very interesting point. I think when one gets recognition, one should not go bigger,
right,
rather, but continue and persist with the work. That's I think, a very important point from your life. Last question, because we don't have much time, which is much in a different take. At point of time when you started your scientific career, this idea of gene therapy was very much in the air. Where is it now?
Oh.
Are we anywhere near it?
Yes, I'll say yes, we are very close. But when I started, as I said, 89, French Anderson in NCI, and our another famous Indian origin scientist, Professor Inder Burma. They are doing tireless work. And I think now with the advent of technology like CRISPR-Cas, mm-hmm. I feel now, although it is still in hype, mm-hmm. it's a big hype because bench to bedside, there are limited trial using adenovirus, another group of virus, the US trial, even Japan, there's diabetes, insulin therapy. But there are problems of side effects. You know, we can cure anything, like let's say we cure diabetes, but we may die out of cancer. Or like, why? Like say insulin, you all know, mm-hmm. type 1 diabetes, because of the insulin deficiency. Insulin is made by a gene. So we have an insulin gene. We have protein also, like insulin, everybody, like not everybody, whoever said take injection. But rather than injection every day, if I get one shot of the gene, and if it can be totally permanently, like our beta cell or pancreas. I'm taking an example of diabetes. So it will be nothing else,
mm-hmm. other than this. Yeah, you'll be completely cured.
Right. But then what happens? Beta cell is damaged. We have only hepatocyte, because this is the highest secretory cells. So we can take the gene to the hepatocyte. But then what happens? It will start making insulin, released in the blood. But then the problem with regulation, there is still don't have the control. Say, like we may suffering from hypoglycemia. Like in beta cell, what is happening? Insulin is being made with the help of glucose sensor. Like my glucose level increasing, insulin started producing. Glucose increasing, insulin is down. There's a sensor, fantastic control sensor, naturally controlled by genetic way or even other non-genetic way in biology. So that control we are still yet to achieve. Like site-specific integration of the genes. Like the insulin gene will be placed in the liver cell chromosome under a operator where the glucose can be sensed. I starts, low, stop.
That is so yet
that
to be
is still yet to be achieved. As far as I'm concerned, even today's explosion, knowledge bloom. But every second is changing world. So this is my personal opinion.
This is, I think, a very important point that you pointed out, that although we have been persisting in this work for more than 3-4 decades, there is a lot more to learn, lot more to understand, because the human biology is very, very complex, very, very intense. There is much more work to be done for you people who are young, who are looking for a career. Here is a great opportunity to make a fundamental difference. Keep watching Eureka. We'll come back with a very interesting conversation next week, same time. And thank you, sir, for being in this show. We had a very wonderful conversation. Thank you.